Okay, this video is called What Are Atrial Fibrillation Causes and Cures? And it comes out of a conversation. You know, my friend's wife's got AFib and, you know, she's not really following the diet and he wanted me to talk to her. So I talked to her, and a lot of the issues that come up routinely talking to patients come up with this. So we'll go through them all. Plus also, I'm just experimenting with this front screen because I was told to make thumbnails and I'm too lazy to do that, but this could essentially do the same thing. All right, so we're gonna go all into atrial fibrillation here. Oh, another thing that came up when I was talking to her was people really, this is a major, major problem for people, is the idea of thinking the correct way about disease, okay? Most people, it's their default setting to try to apply everything to a social lens, and that's fine for social stuff, but it makes you into a screw-up if you try applying that to health. So I'll explain what I mean by biblical thinking versus social thinking in just a sec here. Okay, and the other thing is I always tell people is, look, if you want to understand all of this health and nutrition stuff, live like Adam and Eve, but keep your heating and plumbing. There's not much more to it than that, and it'll simplify the thought process. And the reason, why do I always say that? Eat like Adam and Eve, but keep your indoor heating and plumbing. And here's the reason why. There's tons of toxic chemicals in processed food. There's tons of toxic chemicals in meat. So you really want to avoid this stuff. You know, we've talked about some of these already. The saturated fat inhibits complex 3. When you inhibit mitochondria, what does saturated fat do? This is how you cause insulin resistance. So these other things piling on, like the F minus in the water, the HNE from eating the omega-6 fats, that's a toxic aldehyde byproduct, the lipid peroxidation. They're all going to be damaging mitochondria, worsening insulin resistance, predisposing you to be diabetic, and predisposing you to worsening atrial fibrillation. So there's a good reason for all that, okay? Now I'll start getting into some of the stuff of my conversation with my friend's wife. Okay, so basically, she says what patients typically, most patients think, oh, I'm doing okay. You know, and like I said, they compare themselves, at least I'm not as fat as my cousin, whereas they should say to themselves, what's the best I could do? What's the absolute best I could do? So, you know, she's a very nice lady. She's an intelligent lady. You know, my friend's a real smart guy. And she's like, well, I'm cutting down and I'm doing pretty good. I'm like, no, you're not. You're screwing up. I was actually a little bit mean and rude to her just because I think you have to be. You know, I'm not Mr. Gentle, okay? I'm a wrestler, okay? That's where I come from. And I'm like, I'm sorry, you're screwing up and you're committing suicide and you're stupid, okay? I didn't say it like that. Of course not. But she really couldn't understand that, well, she's reducing the amount of oil she eats. She's been reducing the amount of meat she eats. She's been reducing the amount of nuts she eats. And I said, you're in kidney failure, right? Right, okay? You have hypertension, right? Right. You have diabetes, right? Right. You're over 60, right? Right. You have 4 major risk factors for a massive stroke and a premature senility and death, okay? Your life is in danger. You better wake up. And she has atrial fibrillation. So what I mean by social thinking versus Bible thinking. So social thinking is, you know, when in Rome, do as the Romans do, everything in moderation, go with the flow. That's all stupidity. That does not work for health. That does not work for achievement and success. For achievement and success, you want to think biblically. Thou shalt not eat meat. Thou shalt not eat oil. Okay? You need to be that way because that's what works. And think about it. It's like these are poisons. Think of meat and oil as poisons. Just like you would say to somebody smoking cigarettes or drinking alcohol, you can never have another drop of alcohol. You can never smoke another cigarette. That's what it takes to get better. Because you get older, you're more fragile. Cutting down is not enough. Patients who cut down, they do poorly. Like Esselstyn says, Dr. Esselstyn, he says, moderation kills. These patients have crappy outcomes. This lady is very high risk to die soon and have a massive stroke. You know, I talked to my neurology friends. Plus, I've seen thousands and thousands of strokes. And, you know, what's the most common risk factor for stroke? Hypertension. What's the next risk factor? Some neurologists think it's the worst one. Diabetes. What's the next one? AFib. They actually kind of cause different types of strokes. But what I'm saying is they're all a disaster, these diseases. Anyways, so I tried to get her to realize, no more cutting down. You either stop or you make a will, okay? I mean, I didn't say it quite like that. I tried to be as nice as I could be with my limited social skills. But I had to understand. I said, look, I'm not trying to be mean or be harsh with you, but you have to understand your life is at risk and you are at high risk to die, at high risk to have a major stroke, and cutting down is not going to work. Okay, there's a guy by the name of John Day. He's a electrophysiologic cardiologist, and he's a smart guy, and he means well. He wrote a book about atrial fibrillation. I read the book. I thought it was a pretty good book. He had a quote in there, AFib begets AFib. What that means is the longer you have atrial fibrillation, the more episodes you have, if you're like paroxysmal AFib, the more likely it's going to become a permanent thing. But then, you know, he was interviewed, and he said something I thought was incredibly stupid. He recommended the Mediterranean diet, and it's like, dude, you're smart enough to do an EPS fellowship in cardiology. Open a book and learn something about nutrition. The Mediterranean diet is totally stupid. It's full of fat. It includes alcohol. Alcohol causes AFib. It includes oil. Oil leads to AFib. It includes chicken and fish. Those increase the risk of AFib. It includes a lot of nuts. That's a high-fat food. These are all atherosclerosis, diabetes risk factors, hypertension risk factors. Stupid, okay? The other thing is lots of people are estrogen overloaded, because I talk to a lot of people and they ask me, how come I can't lose weight? I think I'm doing pretty good on the diet. And then they got all these estrogen overload habits, you know. You get exposed to estrogen if you eat processed food. We've talked about this before, from the soy, from the glyphosate, a little bit of a mixed effect of the glyphosate, from the atrazine sprayed on the corn, the sweetener of processed food. Soy is like the protein source for most processed foods. Then you get it from, like I said, the atrazine big time. You get it from tap water. You get it from perfumes, colognes, deodorants, all these personal care products. And so I've given lectures on minimalism, on how to minimize estrogen overload, but that's a big part. It's a fat storage hormone. It's, you know, it goes up high when a woman's pregnant. It tells her store weight. The baby might need it for energy. Starvation was the fear in the past from our ancestors. Okay, diabetes, what causes that? Excessive dietary fat's the main thing, the meat, the oils, and then these mitochondrial inhibitors make it worse, plus something called circa inhibitors. I'll talk a little bit about that in a moment here. And also, what's the diet problem? Excess dietary sodium, lack of potassium and magnesium. When you switch from processed food and meat to plant foods, then you get a lot more magnesium and potassium. Magnesium's in the center, chlorophyll. Potassium is really high in plants, and you avoid the sodium. That's what you want to do. So you'll improve your blood pressure, you'll improve your diabetes, maybe it'll all go away, you'll improve your body weight. By the way, a lot of people have big epicardial fat pads. I see that all the time on chest x-rays. It's a common spot for fat to be stored in fat people. So anyways, what I'm saying is, why does the low-fat, low-sodium vegan diet work so well? Because that's what Adam and Eve ate. That's what our ancestors, that's the species-specific diet that humans are made to eat. So what causes AFib? Well, one major cause is ischemia. If you don't have good blood supply to the heart, then you're going to start losing heart muscle in your atrium, and the conduction pathway will have to go around the ischemic or infarcted, that means dead cardiac muscle. So you want to optimize blood flow. And the longer you're hypertensive, the more problems you'll have. Because chronic high blood pressure means your heart has to pump harder. When your heart has to pump harder, the left ventricle gets thickened. That's LVH, left ventricular hypertrophy. In addition, you're going to have a more prolonged systolic contraction phase of the heart. What that means is you chronically overstretch the ascending thoracic aorta. So you lost the elastic fibers on there. It's going to be more calcified and stiff. And what that means is you're going to be less able to generate diastolic flow. Well, the heart is mostly perfused during diastolic flow. That's when the cardiac muscle relaxes, so the blood in the epicardial coronary arteries can then enter the muscle, the intramyocardial coronaries, all right? So when you got prolonged contraction with a thickened left ventricle, it's harder to get blood into that heart. It's harder to get blood to the heart in general. More blood has to be delivered. You're going to have more ischemia, more problems. High blood cholesterol, increased atherosclerosis risk. Hypertension, increased atherosclerosis risk forming into bifurcations. High triglycerides, increased atherosclerosis risk. Coronary artery disease just means artery of the coronaries, the arteries of the heart. Previous myocardial infarction, MI. Okay, previous cardiac surgery. Congestive heart failure. Again, you're not pumping effectively. Valvular disease is associated with increased risk of AFib. Microvascular angina, that's like in the small vessels of the coronaries. You're going to have open, clear epicardial coronaries. Those are the big ones, the ones that get stented and surgerized. But you can have problems with the intramyocardial branches. That's also sometimes called coronary syndrome X. Okay, alcohol increases the risk of atrial fibrillation. I told her not one drop of alcohol. All right. That's not a problem for her anyways, but still. And then finding the right, you know, Goldilocks balance of exercise. You don't want to just be a couch potato and do no exercise, because that increases the risk of AFib. Being sedentary increases the risk of insulin resistance. Moderate exercise though is great. Mild to moderate exercise. Moderate should be the goal for most people. That's great. You got to be careful about doing marathons or triathlons, because that can actually increase the risk of atrial fibrillation. And I realize there's some people who are really healthy and young who've been doing that, but one also has to be careful, especially starting out and with previous problems. okay, chronic kidney disease, CKD, and she's got that, okay? COPD, chronic obstructive pulmonary disease from smoking cigarettes. Sleep apnea, that makes people hypoxic at night. The hypoxia can lead to episodes of atrial fibrillation. Air pollution is becoming a bigger and bigger problem. It can be a good idea to have a HEPA air filter in the house. I think those are the best ones as far as I'm aware of. Avoid all these stimulants, things like caffeine, tobacco, amphetamines. I worry about giving kids these amphetamine-like stimulants for ADHD in the long run. Sleep deprivation, like working the night shift is bad. That increases your risk of AFib, increases your psychological stress, increases your catecholamines, psychological stress itself. Hyperthyroidism is, in effect, a stimulant, and that can be autoimmune. You know, the classic Hashimoto's super common. Graves is reasonably common. Or somebody who's already had their thyroid out, let's say for thyroid cancer or something, and now they take too many medications, too much levothyroxine, for example, that can cause atrial fibrillation. CERCA inhibitors are something I've talked about in other lectures, and the point is anything that smells bad is bad for you. A lot of these estrogenic chemicals are also CERCA inhibitors. That's sarcoplasm, endoplasmic reticulum, calcium, ATPase inhibitors. They just affect the ability of cells to maximally produce energy, and these are associated with increased insulin resistance. That's why I mention them. Because basically, here's how I see it. The proper attitude, and getting back to this biblical versus social thinking, for a person is to say, look, most people in America age very poorly. They're cognitively impaired by the time they're in their 60s. You don't want that to happen to you. So is there anything you can do to avoid that as an inevitable fate for the typical standard American diet, sad diet eater, and probably for most of these Mediterranean diet eaters as well? And yes, is there anything you can do? Yes, you can go low-fat, low-sodium, vegan. Okay, whole food, 100% vegan. And no alcohol, no sweets, no meats, no dairies, no oils, zero oils. Like Esselstyn says, not one drop. You can do that, and the odds are you'll never have a problem with any of this stuff. You should say, thank you, God. I'll do it. I'll do it. I'll do it. You should have an attitude of gratitude, okay? You don't realize if you keep up with the sad diet, the Mediterranean diet, you're screwed, okay? You plug up your arteries, you're screwed. It doesn't matter how nice a person you are. If you plug up your arteries, you're going to have major problems. Every organ system in the body, including, you know, the heart, works a lot better with good blood flow. Okay, what are other issues? So anything that smells bad, bleaches, paints, dry cleaning chemicals, try to avoid these things. If you have to work with them, make sure the area is really well ventilated. Maybe have a fan. Infection and inflammation. A lot of people have had infections. Inflammation, high CRP is often used as an indicator, even though CRP, there's some issues with that. But anything that's going to make you more prothrombotic. And the other relevance is leaky gut causes increased inflammation in the body. So you go through the checklist, avoid all the stuff that causes leaky gut. I've already done all this stuff, and I follow all this stuff, and it keeps me healthy. I'm 59. I got zero medical problems. And if my life was on the line like, you know, this lady's, I would do all this stuff, get it all right. Because you always want to fix a problem before you have an irreversible event. Once you have a myocardial infarction, a lot of them present with sudden death, okay? It's too late to do anything. Once you have a big stroke, you know, you're hemiplegic potentially. And, you know, you can rehab that gradually over years, but it's hard to turn that around in a big way. Treatments. You might be able, especially if you're younger and you put tons of effort into it, but it takes a long time. Even the famous stroke of insight lady, Jill Bolt Taylor, took her 8 years to turn it all around. Treatments. Pills. You know, there's some pills. They can sometimes help. It's not clear how much aspirin helps, but there's rate control pills, slow things down. There's anticoagulation to help decrease the risk of stroke. There's rhythm control medications. Potentially somebody can be cardioverted. Some of these patients are applicable to that. Sometimes they can do an ablation procedure, but you know, you never know if this stuff's going to work. It's always got the potential for side effect. Why not just prevent it by, you know, eating a healthy diet and having a healthy lifestyle? So the best diet is the same as it always is. The best diet for humans, low fat, low sodium, 100% vegan, 100% whole foods. Okay, no oil, no meat, no dairy, no alcohol. Get some mild to moderate exercise and just do simple stuff that's part of your daily routine. That's a good start. You know, if you're in the basement, go to the bathroom upstairs. If you're upstairs, go to the bathroom in the basement. Park a little farther. Walk a little more. Get some sunshine. Try to have positive relationships with your friends and family and other people, coworkers, etc. Have a purpose in your life so you've got something that sort of drives you and energizes you. And religion really helps lots of people. It gives them additional sense of purpose and meaning in their life and helping other people, all that stuff. So all of these are all the things. And the reason probably we're going through this is tons of patients, they've reversed their atrial fibrillation. It's gone away by doing this. But, you know, This is what you want to do. You get good blood supply into the coronaries so that when that heart has good blood flow, it's more likely to function correctly. And if the sooner you turn it around, the less likely this AFib is going to become a chronic problem for you. So anyways, that was the point of it. And, you know, I wish I could be more socially gentle and tactful, and I try to be, but she had to get it. And I think she got it after talking to me. Her husband thought the whole thing was quite funny. All right, anyways, I hope that helps.